My name is higher.
Welcome to Prescott 83 Sunday Morning Worship Service with Pastor Vince Diegler.
I invite you to turn to chapter 8. And in our study, we've actually been making a lot of progress. If you remember back in the first three chapters, Paul began by focusing in on condemnation, which is important because that explains the importance of the gospel and how necessary the salvation that we have in Jesus Christ actually is. It's because we fall short of the glory of God because we are sinners. He then moved on in the next couple chapters, focusing on justification, how we who are sinners can be declared righteous by God. And he makes it clear it is not by works, it is not by keeping the law, it is not by circumcision or any of those sorts of things. It is by faith in Jesus Christ and Christ alone. And the last few chapters, he has been focusing in on the work of the Holy Spirit, where systematically and progressively his aim is to make us more and more like Jesus Christ. We should understand Christianity is an inside-out transformation. It's an inside-out life experience. And until we understand what we would call the spirit-filled life, the spirit-controlled life, till we understand that and really begin to live that way, we're going to struggle as Christians to experience the life that God intends. I hope it's not redundant, but Jesus said, I have come that you may have life, life to its very full, John 10:10. So immediately I know a couple things. I know this is why Jesus came, and Jesus is the only one that can give me life to its full. If that's what you want, you have to get on the path that goes there. And what Paul is trying to explain is there's only one path, and that is the Spirit-filled life. That's why Jesus said, hey, folks, when he was announcing the fact that he was going to be taken and crucified and eventually leave the disciples, and they were just traumatized by that news, he says, hey, you need to understand this is a good thing, because when I leave, I'm going to send the Holy Spirit, and he will be in you. And when we understand how to live with him in control of our life, we're on the path to experiencing life to its full. And until then, we're never going to get there because it's not available anywhere else. And the reality is, this is where we struggle. We know we should. We know the Bible teaches we're to yield to the Spirit and let him to be in control. But the practical reality of what does that mean and how do you do that is not something that comes to us easily. And I don't think there's any one reason for that. I think it's more a combination of things, starting with the fact that it's a passive relationship. And here's what I mean by that. We were created by God with a free will. And we have spent our entire life exercising that free will. I wake up in the morning and I start thinking about, okay, what do I have in front of me today? And I start making plans and kind of checking on details and all of that kind of stuff, right? You do the same thing. When we talk about the Spirit-filled life, I'm not the one in charge. I'm not the one making the plans. I'm not the one waking up and thinking, okay, what do I got to do in all of this? It's a life of passivity and waiting. And we do that really well, don't we? We all are extremely patient people, and we'll just wait. right? No, we are programmed to be doers. And the Spirit-filled life is a life of submitting our will to the Holy Spirit. It's like, instead of waking up in the morning and deciding, okay, this is what I need to do. It's like waking up in the morning and saying, okay, God, what would you like today? What would you have me accomplish today? How would you like to shape me and change me today? And we give the day to him and let him set the agenda. So it's passive. It's also in the realm of the spiritual. And we've lived our whole life in the physical. If I'm having a conversation with Greg, I can see him. I can hear him. If I wanted to, I could touch him. I hope I don't smell him, but in certain contexts, that might be true too. We know how to relate to people in the physical realm. How do you relate to someone that's invisible, that doesn't talk audibly to you, that is operating in the realm of the Spirit? How do we do that? That's uncharted waters. That's unfamiliar. And that's why I say it's very, very unnatural. It seems kind of strange. It probably feels a little bit awkward right up until you start experiencing the Holy Spirit working in your life. And the more you experience that, the more normalized it becomes. I've often suggested to people in a counseling situation, one of the reasons people look for counseling is because stuff is going on in their life, right? Well, for them, that is normal. If you're a healthy individual and you think about the life of maybe an alcoholic or an addict, you would think, man, that's abnormal. Who would want to do that? Here's the reality. For them, that is normal. Living a healthy life is abnormal. So they have to turn their normal into something that is abnormal. And that's called a process. You don't do that overnight. It takes time. But you're operating in a realm where, well, I'm used to this. This is my comfort zone. Yeah, for 99% of the population, it would be horrible. But for me, it's very comfortable. It's known territory. And to get over here, that's a strange, awkward journey. That's kind of what we're talking about here. This is not natural to us. What's natural to us is doing our own thing, going our own way, living our own life, pursuing our own agenda, and we're bombarded with a society that tells us, and that's exactly how you ought to live. You're number one. Watch out for number one. And Jesus would say to every one of us, no, step one is deny yourself. Take up your cross, follow me. Jesus would say, you're not number one. I am. You exist to bring glory to me. And that is completely countercultural to the world we live in. But it's also the path to discovering life to its very full. And that's why today's text is so very important. Because it hopefully is going to help us get a little bit more comfortable and get a little bit more clarity on how to actually live the Spirit-filled life. So we're going to start in Romans 8, verse number 9, and we're going to work down at first to verse 13. Eventually, we're going to get all the way down to verse 17. Paul writes, if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, well, they don't belong to Christ. But if Christ is in you, then even though your body is subject to death because of sin, the Spirit gives life because of righteousness. And if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, and remember, if you're a child of God, he is. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies because of his Spirit who lives in you. Therefore, brothers and sisters, we have an obligation, but it is not to the flesh to live according to the flesh. For if we live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the misdeeds of the body, you will live. Step number one, according to Paul, in experiencing a Spirit-filled life is to understand it starts with a personal surrender, if you will. And that's directly tied to the simple fact that when we become Christians, the Spirit of the living God, the one who raised Jesus from the dead, takes up residence in our life. Now there's many scriptures we could use to support that. I wanted to look at this passage. It's Ephesians 1, verse 13 and 14, and it talks about the work of the Spirit, and you also were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and when you believed, here's what happened, you were marked in Him, or you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. And He is a deposit or a down payment, guaranteeing our future inheritance. And keep that idea of inheritance in mind, because we're going to close with it when we get to the end, which will be sometime today. He is guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession, to the praise of His glory. The Bible says when we believed, we were sealed with the Holy Spirit, and that means a couple very, very important things. First of all, it means we are God's possession. I should probably do that. Nope. I'll go back. We are God's possession. We belong to Him. It denotes authority. Do you remember when they buried Christ? And the leaders of Judaism were afraid that the disciples were going to steal the body and say He resurrected, so they wanted Pilate to seal it. The reason they wanted Pilate to seal it was to show that that tomb was under the authority of Rome. And to break that seal is to basically attack Rome. That's what seals are. This is mine. I have authority over it. You are not entitled to break the seal. It's not yours. It's mine. So it denotes possession. It denotes the fact that we belong to God and He has authority over our lives. It denotes assurance. That's what verse 14 is trying to convey. The Holy Spirit acts as a down payment, and the down payment guarantees everything that Christ has promised me by way of my salvation will eventually be mine. That inheritance is sure. You take all those concepts and add it together, you get a fourth one, and it's the idea of security. When we are sealed by God, it is God's way of saying to us, you are mine, and everything I promised you is secure. So the moment we become Christians, we're sealed with the Holy Spirit. He now takes up residence in our life. When we think about Him being there, we need to understand He's there as God's change agent. So I want to look now at Ephesians 4, because it again talks about the Spirit and what He is trying to accomplish in our life. Ephesians 4, starting in verse 20. That, however, is not the way of life you learned when you heard about Christ and were taught in Him in accordance with the truth that is in Jesus. You were taught with regard to your former way of life to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires. Now, I want to stop right there and point out a couple things, because this is, and I would encourage you to mark this, memorize this, dwell on this often. I think this is one of the most important passages in all of the New Testament for us as believers. The moment we come to Jesus Christ, this text tells us the Holy Spirit starts teaching us. We start learning. Well, what's He teaching us? What are we learning? a completely different way to approach life. Where does that start? Starts in our mind. I have to advance to see that. To be made new in the attitude of your minds. Starts up here. Or down here. Heart, mind, they're almost synonymous in Scripture. It talks about where the direction of our life is determined. Proverbs says, keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it come the issues of life. When the Holy Spirit is not there and we are self-controlled, out of our heart comes the direction of our life. Now we have the Holy Spirit. We have to let Him be in charge of our heart. And when He's in charge, He directs what comes out of our life, what direction our life will take. And I would suggest to you that that means we need to give Him something to work with. If we talk about how come we struggle, I probably should have introduced this in the beginning. One of the reasons we struggle, and I don't know if this is the best word, but if you starve the Holy Spirit for information or tools to work with, you could have the best mechanic in Modesto. Take away his tools, he's no good. What are the tools the Holy Spirit uses? One of the tools, and it takes many forms, is Scripture. And it might be Scripture I've memorized. It might be Scripture I'm reading in my daily time with God. It might be Scripture I hear in a sermon or in a conversation with someone else. But God uses Scripture. And if I am not saturating my life with Scripture, how in the world is the Holy Spirit going to bring to mind the different scriptural principles I need to be directed? Well, He can't. That's why David said, thy word have I hidden my heart or treasured up in my heart so that I wouldn't sin against thee. I got to give the Holy Spirit something to work with. He uses us, each other. We just covered in our Thursday night study over at June's house in the book of Hebrews chapter 10 that we are to encourage one another and consider how we can stimulate one another to love and good works. The Holy Spirit uses us. I've shared before how, and I won't bore you this time, but Stuart has often challenged me and encouraged me and stimulated me to do the right thing when I was intent on not doing the right thing. And God used him. Because the Holy Spirit uses the people in our lives. That tells me, you better have some good, healthy, mature people in your life who will hold you accountable when you're acting like a knucklehead. I got that word from Greg. I think it's an ancient Hebrew word. A bonehead, okay, same thing. I qualify for both. I qualify for both. And I need people in my life to hold me accountable. Because sometimes I know exactly what God wants me to do, I'm just not interested. And I need people to help me get interested. You see what I'm saying? How in the world can God renew my mind if I don't give him anything to work with? Now, if we think about this learning, this teaching, I want to suggest there's two basic lessons that he's teaching us. The first is down at the bottom of verse number 22. You were taught with regard to your former way of life. So thinking about the way you've been approaching life prior to the Holy Spirit comes to town. What does he begin to immediately do? He begins to teach you regarding that way of life to put it off. Get rid of it. Well, why? He tells us. Which is being corrupted. That means it's falling apart. It's unraveling. It is in the state of decay. You say, well, I don't think so. Then why'd you turn to Christ? There's a reason people turn to Christ. And it's not because everything is wonderful. It's because our life is a ball of yarn. And it's like, what am I supposed to do with this? I need help. We turn to Christ, and all of a sudden we think we've got it all figured out. And we don't need him anymore. And that's not what Paul say. Paul say, you know what? You probably need him more than ever now. You need to learn how to put aside that old approach to life. Because that old life, just like it was falling apart in the past, if you try to live that way now, it's going to keep on falling apart. And he tells us the reason it's falling apart. It's because our desires deceive us. How many times in your life have you been absolutely convinced that you know exactly what you need to be happy and satisfied? I've been there. Oh man, if I could just get, in my case, that girl, for you, it might be that guy. If I could just get that job, if I could just get into that school, if I could just get those classes, if I could just major in this, if I could get that loan to make this purchase, whether it's a house or a car, whatever, you fill in the blank. If I could just, only to get it. You get exactly what you thought would be perfect. And what do you find out? It's not so perfect. It's not what you thought. It's not what you expected. It's not the answer. And often at that point, you are worse off than you were before. Well, what do you learn from that? Here's what I learned from that. God knows a whole lot more about what I need and what will make me happy and what will give my life meaning and satisfaction. He knows a whole lot more about that than I do. Because my desires deceive me, and when I pursue them, somehow it all keeps unraveling. So the Holy Spirit, when he comes to town, immediately starts teaching me to put off that way of living. That desire-based approach to life, and to replace it with, if you look at verse 24, and put on the new self. Well, what's the new self? The new self is the self that the Holy Spirit is trying to produce and create within me. It's an inside-out transformation. Notice what it says. He's teaching me to be like God. He's teaching me to understand and live in true righteousness and true holiness, because that protects me from my deceiving desires. So he teaches me to put off the old. And he starts recreating me from the inside out. And he teaches me step by step, day by day, to be like God and to live in righteousness and holiness. And if we're going to diagram it, it would look something like that. It's a rest of our life process where the Holy Spirit starts teaching me. And we don't even understand all the ways the flesh has kind of gotten tangled up in our entire being. And that's why for the rest of our life, we're going to be putting off those residual after effects of the time we've spent outside of Jesus Christ. And for the rest of our life, we're going to be putting on the new self. Because no matter how high you get on that upward line, on the put-on line, until you get to heaven, there's always room for growth. Not until you get to heaven will you be made perfect. And until then, there's always room for growth. And so for the rest of our life, we're going to be putting off and putting on. And when we get here, that represents a choice. I can listen to the Holy Spirit, the things He's trying to say to me through Scripture or other believers, or about how I've made choices in the past, or areas of my life that are lacking. They are missing elements of Christ-likeness. I can listen to Him, or I can ignore Him and retain control. Now, best thing I know to do when you're in a decision-making mode is to look at the consequences. So I'm going to wrap up this part by looking at the consequences of that choice. The acts of the flesh, when I retain control and decide I know better than the Holy Spirit, I'm going to live this way, my life. Here's what I should expect. The acts of the flesh are obvious. Sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfishness, ambition, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. Now, some of that stuff I would say, oh, I would never. You would too. But some of that stuff up there, if I looked in the mirror, you know what I would see? Me. Some of that stuff describes me. It doesn't describe me when I'm walking with God and having the Spirit in control. It describes Vince when Vince is being Vince. And that's not what I want. That's not what I would want for my loved ones. In fact, when I look at that list of the acts of the flesh, I say that they are ugly and undesirable. And I don't want them in my life, but whether or not I like them and whether or not I want them in my life, here's the reality that Paul is trying to explain to us. If the Spirit of God is not in control of your life, that's exactly what's going to happen. I don't know much about fruit trees, but I don't think an apple tree has to work hard at making apples. I think that's what apple trees do. Now, they might have a challenge if you want an apple tree to make oranges, but I don't think they have a hard time making apples. It's what they do. It comes naturally. You give them the conducive environment to grow. They got roots in the ground. They got nourishment. They got water. They're going to grow apples because that's what they do. When you operate in the flesh, that's what happens. And it's inescapable. Look at our world, which the Bible says is under the domain of Satan. He is called the god of this world. Sin and death reign in this world. That is a description of our world. And it's ugly and it's undesirable. But when we allow the Holy Spirit to have control, look at what happens. The fruit of the Spirit. Now think about it, because the analogy holds true. Apple trees don't work hard to grow apples. It comes naturally. You let the Spirit of God be in control. Love isn't so difficult. Joy isn't so difficult. You don't have to grit your teeth and like you're getting ready to do a bench press. Oh, I'm gonna be joyful. No, you're just going to be joyful. Because that's what the Holy Spirit does. He makes you joyful. He makes you loving. He makes you a man or a woman of peace. He gives you patience and kindness and goodness and faithfulness and gentleness and self-control. And I don't know about you, but when I look at that list, especially in contrast to the previous list, I say, I want a whole lot more of that. Because you know what? When those virtues are defining me, I am a better person. And if those virtues would describe our world would be a better place. And there's one way to get there, and only one way. It's called personal surrender. Just like Jesus in the garden. Lord, not my will. I don't want to go to the cross. Nevertheless, not my will. I want your will. I want what you have for me to accomplish to be the highest priority of my life. And that means every single morning we wake up and we say to God, what is it that you have for me today? I want you to set the agenda. I want you to make the plan. If there's stuff in me that doesn't belong there, I want you to show it to me so it can be dealt with and put off. If there's parts of me that are missing, I want you to put them in me, bring them to light so that I can pursue those things. The rest of our life will be a life of putting off and putting on. Now, let's look at a second step, because I said there'd be two lessons. And the second lesson kind of grows out of the first. We'll read verses 14 to 17. For those who are led of the Spirit of God, well, they're the children of God. The Spirit you receive does not make you slaves so that you live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you receive brought about your adoption to sonship. And by him we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are the children of God. And if we are the children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we share in his sufferings, in order that we may also share in his glory. Now, we start breaking down what Paul's saying. And again, what we need to understand is this grows out of personal surrender. That was step one. Every single day I make an intentional decision. I will not be in charge. The Holy Spirit will be. The second step, I'm calling it practice sensitivity. And here's what I'm getting at. We have spent our entire life exercising our will, living life on our terms. And because that is true, I can make a personal surrender at 7:30 a.m. and by 8:30 a.m. be totally in charge of my life once again and not even realize I've done it. Because it's the most natural thing for me to do is for me to think in Vince-like ways and make choices in Vince-like ways and then pursue whatever decision I've made to put it into practice. And it might not even be a bad thing. It might be a perfectly good thing. Remember that passage in James? Go to now. It's a confrontational statement. You that say today or tomorrow we're going to go into such a city, continue there a year, buy and sell and get gain. Hey, I have all life all figured out. And James says, you know what you ought to say? If the Lord wills, we'll live. And then, if the Lord wills, we'll do this or that. Doesn't have to be bad things. I don't have to wake up in the morning and decide I'm going to go out and rob a bank for that to be evil. All I have to do is wake up in the morning, ignore the Holy Spirit, and do my own thing. So the reason I'm calling this practicing sensitivity is because it is just so very easy for me to retake the control of my life. I need to learn how to be led as opposed to leading. I already know how to lead my life. Not so much on the being led. Just ask anyone who's tried to lead me. They'll tell you how good I'm at being led. Look at Romans 12. This is Paul. A little bit later in our study, we'll get here. Do not be conformed to the pattern of this world. Everyone in this world lives this way. They pursue their desires. They pursue their interests. They wake up in the morning. They are in control. They decide what they're going to do. They make decisions. They pursue them. And Paul says, step one, don't live like that. If that's the way the world does it, don't do it that way. Well, what am I supposed to do? He goes back to the same thing he said back in the Ephesians 4 passage. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Let the Holy Spirit start teaching you a completely different way to live. And remember, there were two lessons. Put off the old self and put on the new self. So let him start teaching you that completely new way of life. And when you get there, what will he do? Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve. It's the idea of discovery. It comes right out of the marketplace of the ancient world where you had currency from the four corners of the globe, and it's all different. And how do I know a Yugoslavian nickel is the same value as an American nickel? I don't. So you know what they had? They had scales. And they didn't care what was minted on the coin. They cared about how much it weighed. And my bag of wheat costs this much. And I don't care what the coin says. You need to put that much gold or that much silver or that much whatever we're weighing. You need to put that much on it to balance out the scales. That's called testing and approving. And when the Spirit of God is able to start renewing my mind and teach me how to live, all of a sudden, look at what it says, then you will be able. I gain the ability by having the Spirit of God in control to be able to discover what God's will is. And doesn't that imply I could never figure that out apart from him? I think so. If I could figure it out apart from him, I wouldn't need him. That's why he says, when this is true, you will be able to test and approve what God's will is. Here's why God's will is important. It's good. It's pleasing. It's perfect, meaning it's the complete package. There's no missing pieces there. So I need to practice being led. Just, well, you know what? I dedicated the day to God at 7:30 in the morning. That's not good enough, because I guarantee you, just drive to work. And more than likely, that's all that it will take. Just one stupid driver does one stupid thing that gives you an attitude, and guess what? You know, remember those fruits of the Spirit? Did you notice road rage was not one of them? You see what I'm getting at? Just a drive to work, an innocent drive to work. Boom. I need to be rededicating or practicing spiritual sensitivity. When I get there, I need to hurry up. What will I find? I will experience freedom. Now, there's a bit of a contradiction here. I'm not going to go back to the text, but Paul wrote to the Romans and said, the Holy Spirit will not make you a slave. But you know what he said in previous chapters? We go from being slaves to sin to slaves to Christ, right? So there's a bit of contradiction. The idea is the Spirit will not enslave us in a hurtful way as what we've experienced in the past when we were a slave to sin or when we were a slave to the law. When the Holy Spirit enslaves you, it's a completely different thing. And here's what he's getting at in this passage. I want you to think about when you are in control, who's responsible? What are you responsible for? Everything. I've got to make it work. I mean, I've got one shot at life. I've got one today. If the sun comes up, I've got one tomorrow. I've got to make it work. And with that comes what Paul referred to as fear, guilt, or what I would call stress. What did we learn earlier about life? God knows better than I do what I need to make me happy and meaningful and satisfied. But I've said, no, I'm gonna handle this. So I'm gonna have all the fear and all the guilt and all the stress of trying to make life work. And what Paul's saying here is the Holy Spirit's not gonna do that to you. Because in the Holy Spirit, he describes our relationship not as being slaves, but here he uses this phrase, we are adopted as sons. And the position of a son is the contrast to that of a slave. I think we would all agree, a slave's life is unpleasant, and that's being kind. It's a whole different package being a son. Because you know what sons do? They depend on their parents. Because the parents take care of sons. That's the whole idea of a child. You need someone to take care of you. I'm the person that brought you into the world, so I'm the person that takes care of you. Now, when you become an adult, you're on your own. But while you're a child, while you're a son, the parent's job is to take care of you. In this context, who is the parent? God. So I go from being a slave where everything is on me to make it work to being a son, and I kick back and say, okay, God, you take me to life to its very full, and I'll just enjoy the ride because I believe you and only you can get me where I want to go. We have a relationship with God defined as the adoption as sons, and in that experience there is security and God's grace, meaning nothing we could ever do and no one on this planet could ever do anything to sever that relationship with him. We experience the freedom of sonship. Now, I want to close by focusing in and just a little bit more deeply on that idea of sonship. Because, again, if you have your text open to Romans 8, you'll notice that this is a point Paul really emphasizes in this passage. He introduces it in verse 14, where we're called the children of God. Verse 15, we're adopted as sons. We cry, Abba, Father. Verse 16, we're called the children of God again. In verse 17, we're called children and heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. Now, here's what we need to understand. We were not born that way. In fact, when we were born, because of our sin nature, the Bible describes us as being in Satan's family and not God's. That's why we need to be born again. And the new birth, Paul says, results in us being adopted into God's family. Now, I don't know how many of you know this. I'm adopted. I couldn't have picked out my biological dad from a lineup. He left before I was 1 year old. I never had any experience with him whatsoever my entire life. And I found out he died in like 97 or 98. Long story. He had a big family. There were two left, my Aunt Mildred, my Aunt Fanny. One of them had Alzheimer's. The other one cared for her. The caregiver broke her hip. They both went in a home. They had a bunch of stuff up in their attic, some of which pertained to my brother and I's biological dad. They gave us a box of stuff and said, look into it. It's up to you. It pertains to you. And so I found out he died in the late 90s. Could not pick him out of a lineup. But my mom remarried when I was in high school, and my dad adopted me. It's the only dad I've ever known my whole life. I did not have his DNA. I had his dadship from high school on until he passed away. Because adoption doesn't change your DNA, does it? Don't be so quick. What did we get with the Holy Spirit? That's God in us. We do have spiritual DNA. We are directly related to God in a DNA kind of way. And I find that to be incredible, because DNA determines what we will be. Our size, our shape, our hair color, our eye color, our health. I'll give you an idea. When I look at my grandparents and my mom and her brothers and sisters and their children and my brother, you know what I see? I see me. I see a family resemblance. I could see parts of me in every single one of them. I was thinking about my cousins. My brother is the shortest of all the male part of that DNA group, and he's 6'2". And my brother, I have two cousins that are the same size as me, 6'5". And we've got 6'4s and 6'3s, but nobody shorter than 6'2". Why? Well, my grandfather was tall. My uncle was tall. Even my aunts are tall. I wouldn't call my mom tall, but that's because I'm 6'5". I think a lot of people are much shorter than what they are. I'm sorry. I did not write the song, Short People Got No Reason. I did not. But I use it often. Anyway, I'm going to get back on track here. We have spiritual DNA by virtue of the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. And when you let him lead, guess what? The family likeness of being a part of God's family is going to come out. And he closes with that thought of inheritance. He calls us heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. Here's the question when you start thinking about inheritance, right? We'll be greedy materialists, ugly Americans. Well, what do they own? What does God own? God owns everything. That means one day he is going to give me everything. And we ought to appreciate what we have in him. Remember the story of the prodigal son? There's actually two prodigals in the story. One squandered his inheritance. The other resented his father. So there's two prodigals. We shouldn't be like either one of them. We should appreciate what we have in the fact that we are the children of God. Now let me wrap this up for today. So we started with the premise that the spirit-filled life is a little bit awkward, a little bit unnatural, a little bit uncomfortable, a little bit mysterious, kind of uncharted waters for us. And I hope today was helpful. I don't think it was a light bulb moment where, oh, now I've got it all figured out, and oh, man, rest of my life, 1, 2, 3, simple as pie. But I do want us to be real this morning in this sense. There's a huge difference between knowing what we ought to do and actually doing what we ought to do. And basically what we talked about today was an awful lot of very important information that is needed to be able to experience a spirit-filled life. But the reality is now the doing begins. Okay, I know that I need to personally surrender to God every single day. And then as I live the day, I need to practice sensitivity because it's just so easy for me to re-seize control. So now the doing starts. Here's what I want us to remember. The doing is not about perfect. If we could be perfect, the Bible would be so much shorter. It really would be. We don't do perfect. It's just too easy for us to re-seize control. So don't think about doing this perfectly. Think about making progress. Because if you start implementing, you start waking up in the morning and intentionally having a conversation with God, and you invite him to take the lead and set the agenda and to work on you, he will start doing that. And then if you live the day by being sensitive to his leading and allowing him to speak to you in all the different ways that he's desirous of doing that, and you really practice sensitivity, slowly but surely your life will begin to reflect his control. And that means slowly but surely you will start experiencing life to its very full. And that's why Jesus came. Let's close in prayer. Father, thank you for a really good passage of Scripture that I know has helped me in my walk with you. It is just so easy for me to just do my own thing, to just wake up and hit the ground and start thinking about all the things I need to do. And it's just too easy for me to not to pause and say, is this anywhere close to what you want, Lord? And so I found this to be very helpful, and I pray it would be true, because I know something with all my heart is that until your spirit is in control, we're going to struggle in our pursuit of life to its full. But when your spirit is in control, it is transformational. And so, Father, I lift these words up to you. I ask that you would take them and that where they need to sink in and begin to change us, I pray that they would. In Jesus' name, amen.